Hi, I'm Matt from BitSasty. We're a digital innovation agency, and today we're going to talk about vibe coding and what it is, and go do a little demonstration of an application I built last night to help me plan my Padel tournament. So we'll start off with what is vibe coding. I've written a little blog post that you can read more about it there, so I won't go into too much detail, but at a high level, it's using AI coding tools to create software rapidly. So this is really good for if you're building prototypes or a small application for yourself, such as the case here with the Padel tournament. The reason it's not so great for more complex applications or applications you're going to push into production is the risk that because you're not really interrogating the code very closely, that you could accidentally let slip a security vulnerability or a performance issue that could then rack up a lot of costs if malicious users start attacking your application. So caveat this quite heavily that you really shouldn't use this process for anything too serious, but it's a really great for a proof of concept, or if you're building a small tool that's just going to be used for yourself. And in this case, this Padel application is just using local storage. There's no database, so it's all run in your browser. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about how I built this. To start off with, I sort of described what I was trying to build in Claude. And I wanted to use Claude Code, which is a relatively new agent for interacting with your code base. You can install it by just typing in, I'll link to the installation instructions. But you can just type Claude, and once you've authenticated, you can ask it to do certain things to your code base. And in the initial prompt that I gave it was basically a high-level description of what I was building. And I had asked Claude, before I pasted the prompt into Claude Code, to give a technical breakdown of how it should be architected. So it decided to use React and Vite and Tailwinds, and it started to install that and then get that working. However, there were a few issues with the code that Claude Code generated. First, the configuration for Tailwinds was incorrect, and so none of the styles were loading. It was looking like a really basic HTML page. The second issue was I was prompting it to trying to get it to fix itself, but what had happened is after you clicked create tournament, nothing was happening. The screen went blank and it wasn't working. So after sort of struggling with Claude Code and burning, I don't know, $5 worth of tokens, I decided to take a different approach, and for that I used Cursor. And I'm going to sort of talk you through my chat history that I had with Cursor, highlighting some of the interesting limitations that some of these AI tools have, as well as what it can be quite good for. So if I go back to my history and go to sort of, let's go to that one. Yeah. So no, that was the correct one. I just have to load the actual history, load all the older messages. Okay, one second. All right. So here I'm explaining what I'm trying to build and what the bug was, which was after pressing the start tournament button, nothing happened. And the Cursor managed to resolve the issue. It managed to find the bug, it was like some sort of callback that was missing. And it sort of managed to, at this point, it was sort of working. The display was a bit off, and sort of how I wanted the scores to work was not quite right. So I gave it an example of how I'd like the tournament details to be presented to me. It didn't work, and so I gave it to it again. And then at this point here, you can give additional context to your chat messages. So here I passed in the whole source code of the application, because it's quite a small application. If it was a bigger application, you'd probably only want to pass in relevant context. So it could be the file that you're working in, or a set of files that you're working in, or a folder. And in this way, in this case, after it, so with, once it had the context of the application, it did find the issue and it fixed the issue. So at this point, I had a working application. The styles were still broken, didn't look very good. And there were still some weird issues with some UX issues that I found with the application. So here's, at this point, I was just trying to get some of these UX issues fixed first before I started fixing the UI issues. Now, up until this point, I still haven't looked at the source code that the application was generating. I was trusting that the AI was generating good code and that it worked correctly. But as you can see here, there's a lot of times where I was running into bugs where certain things weren't working. I was testing this manually. I could have used AI to generate some tests for me as well. And that would be what I'd consider good practice, to make sure that you're writing your tests first and make sure that those tests are either failing, and then you ask the AI to fix the failing test. That said, because it was a very simple application and I was short on time last night before my tournament today, I was testing it manually and getting through it quickly. The At this point here, the application was working, but the styles that it was, some of these Tailwind styles were still not correct. So I was giving it some prompts to, you know, give some styles. And here you can see, even though I was asking it to update the styles, one of the first things it did, it updated this line of code, which has nothing to do with the styles. And it's a really good example of how sometimes AI agents can go a little bit rogue and start, you know, editing things, messing with things which are not strictly what you've asked it to do. And here's another one. But this one is actually more relevant. It was somewhat to do with the styles. I would strongly recommend when you're using these AI agents, AI tools, to make sure you're frequently saving your work in a version control like Git and creating Git commits for every single round of iteration that you're using these tools. So you can easily roll back to different versions of the code base if there's an issue and it starts to delete random code that it shouldn't. So at this point, it says it's done, the styling looks good, but really the styles weren't being applied when I was looking at the application. Something's wrong. And then this is an example where it couldn't figure out what was wrong. It decided that, okay, maybe I just need to change some of these styles and, you know, define these cuts in the config. It still didn't work. So then I pasted the generated code and highlight the fact that Tailwinds wasn't being included properly. It then decided that let's try and check if Tailwinds is installed. And then it realized that it's using a old version of the Tailwinds config to include Tailwinds. And it's using Tailwinds 4, so it should use it has a different syntax. And this highlights an example where, because the large language models that these AI agents tools use, they are trained on data that can be months old. And when you're working in software, things move quite rapidly. You can paste a link to, say, source code, like documentation or like library documentation that you're using, and the cursor will then pick up the new documentation, and so will Claude Code. But yeah, I think I'd recommend either not using the bleeding edge of certain tools, or if you are, make sure that you're referencing those library documentation in your cursor prompts to make sure that you're not going to fall foul of issues like this where it's using old versions of tools. Anyway, so it fixed that issue, and now the app was pretty much done. It looked good. A couple of other UX tweaks I was asking it to fix here. Still haven't looked at any of the source code at this point, and it was working okay, and said, let's ship it. So I asked it to help me deploy it to Cloudflare. It was generating old Cloudflare configs, and it used the correct command, but then that didn't work, and then it started using an incorrect, like an outdated command, a deprecated command to deploy. So then after a bunch of fixing some type issues before it could deploy, it then decided to run the deploy command. That didn't work because the config was out of date. It updated the config and then switched from deploy to publish, which I think is the newer command and not the deprecated command. So at this point, it's the other way around. At some point, decided to switch to the publish command, which is out of date. It is deprecated. The current command is deploy. So this is a good example of it getting itself in a loop and then finally managing to get back out of that loop. Don't want to know how many tokens I burnt during that process, but c'est la vie. And yeah, and then again, now it's deployed. I'm starting to play with it on my actual phone. I gave it some more feedback on how to work. Now, at this point, this is today after my tournament, I realized that there's some issues with the code base, and I probably should have interrogated how it was doing certain things more cleanly, closer. Here was a bug that I didn't discover through my manual testing, which was some of the pairings were being matched too often. It wasn't rotating them fairly. And I think it was to do with this player skill function that it had in place. So I said, let's just remove that to simplify the algorithm for the match. So I removed the player skill, and then I asked it to simplify the matching, which then goes ahead and does it here. And it's still using the skill difference. Interesting. So I think at some point, yes. Actually, is it still using the skill difference? I need to check that. But that should have been removed. And then now at this point, I asked it to write a test and explain in detail how I'd like the test to function so that I can then check that the algorithm is working as expected. And that now passes, so I'm relatively confident that it should be okay going forward. Although it didn't have Jest installs in it, I just forced Jest to run the test suite. And that. So yeah, that was it. I did another little bit of iteration to improve some of the UX. So I guess this is an example of how having some knowledge of software development can really help when you're prompting these tools to get to the output you want, because using plain language can be hard because you're really relying on the AI then to intuit what you want to happen based on your natural language prompt. instead of being a bit more direct with using the more technical terms of how you'd like it to resolve something. So on a small mobile screen, names were being truncated. So that's this issue here. And then I gave it some ideas of how we could fix that. So for example, making the names a label, moving the input field underneath the label to give it more space, making the names label mean I can easily click on the name to activate the input field, and then making it easier to type the input field by using displaying a number key. So then I went ahead and made these changes, and you can see it. See that these are the changes here. It changes the input type to numeric, gave it a pattern, and yeah, changed the way it was displayed. Yeah, so it's all running locally. You know, you can give it a date. So let's give it today's date, maybe. Layers in. One more. All right. And then that's it. You can sort of start putting in your scores for your tournament. And then it'll generate a leaderboard. And then once you've completed the tournament, you'll have the full summary of the rounds played and the scores were. And so, yeah, this is a fun little app demonstration of how you can use vibe coding to create something quite simple very quickly. I think all in all, majority of the time was spent fixing setup bugs and deployment issues than actual coding the code. So, yeah, I think it's a really powerful tool that you can use in your arsenal when you're trying to create quick prototypes or test something, you know, quickly, throw away proof of concept that you then go ahead and build properly later. If you like this video, don't forget to like and subscribe.